Hello everyone, welcome to the SAP Community Call on the topic SAP Globalization Services. This is Lea Becker speaking. I'm from the SAP Community Team. And with me today, we have three presenters. We have Stefan Steinle. He is the head of SAP Globalization Services here at SAP. And his prime target is to ensure that SAP's customers can leverage SAP software to extend and grow their business globally in all geographies across the world. Our second speaker is Jan Klaas-Heinsohn. He is also on the team of Stefan and he's responsible for strategic innovation topics in the globalization team at SAP, which I just mentioned. And finally, we have Vivek Gola Pudi as the third speaker. I hope this is pronounced correctly. and Vivek is the business assistant to Stefan. So I'm really happy to have you here. And I would like to hand over to you so you can start your presentation.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks a lot, Svea. And yeah, this is Stefan Steinle speaking. As mentioned, I am heading SAP Globalization Services since a couple of months. And yeah, it's a great opportunity, of course, to showcase what we are doing a little bit to the outside world, to the SAP community today. And I think this is, from our point of view, important for the following reason. I think many of you, many of our customers, partners, they consider localization as something that is necessary and something that just drives efforts in the implementation or when running an SAP system. And our target in the next 50, 60 minutes is to show you that localization is indeed something different, that localization is indeed something innovative and something that adds value not only to our business in the sense of being a competitive advantage to SAP and our software, but that also adds value to the business of our customers. And I think this is definitely what we want to showcase here today. We will split it in the following way. I will present localization, software localization at SAP in a more generic way. Jan Klaas will then take over and showcase some of the more innovative services that we offer to our customers. And also Vivek will then give a demo of one of these services. I think this gives you an opportunity to have, first of all, an overview on what we are doing and our offering, but as well take a little bit of a deeper look on how we work today in the world of software localization. Yeah, to start with, I think an issue which many of our customers, many of our partners who implement software are facing is that really when you look across the world, there are more and more regulations upcoming that need to be considered when we implement or run processes based on SAP software. We have a lot of new legal requirements upcoming in practically all parts of the world. So it's not only like in the maybe 10, 15 years ago where everybody said, yeah, Brazil is complex in terms of localization. Today we have more and more legal requirements that are upcoming across the world that make running and operating an SAP based software landscape at our customers really complex and really cumbersome in many regards. So these are just a couple of examples of upcoming evolving global regulations. I think there are many, many more examples. And of course, also what we need to consider here is that a lot of governance, they want to automate their processes as well. They want to prevent the companies in their country from conducting tax fraud and stuff like that. This is also one of the sources of evolving global regulations across the world. So the world for us and the world for our customers who implement and run SAP software becomes, I would say, from a localization perspective, more and more complex. And this is also definitely a topic we deal at SAP very much. Now, when we take a look at how do we approach that at SAP, what do we do in order to support our customers to deal with the challenges that I have just mentioned. We have a team, a development unit at SAP, which is called SAP Globalization Services. And what we practically do is for a vast majority of our software products, we are in charge of the localization, of making sure that these software solutions run locally. And localization in our regard, I'll come to that in a bit more detail, is of course for all of our software components is a translation piece. So language, we translate SAP products in up to 59 languages. Of course, not each product in each language, but this is the maximum scope that we offer in terms of the language scope. And for some of our products, there are also local business practices, local legal requirements, things like business to government communication and so on that we have to consider. If you look on the left side at the product range, I think the majority of local requirements we have for the solutions that are mentioned here, and I think also when we look at the ones that are mentioned on top, like S4HANA, payroll, HCM, SuccessFactors, of course also our SME solutions, SAP Concur, SAP Ariba, these are solutions that are very heavy with regards to requirements in terms of local business practices, local legal requirements, and these are the ones we also have a strong focus as an organization within SAP. Now, our mission, as mentioned, is to empower all businesses to run compliant locally and also compete globally, and this is what we are supposed to explain now in a little bit more detail in the next couple of minutes. When we talk about globalization at SAP, we speak about three main pillars. First of all, it is the internationalization. These are the capabilities that make our software ready to be localized. Topics like Unicode enablement, time zone support, supporting of multiple currencies and multiple languages are typical examples here. So this is what we call internationalization. For our very established products, this is of course something which is just available and needs some updates here and there, but also for some of the new products, this is of course something we take care of right at the beginning. A second piece is what we call functional localization. So this is really the development, the engineering of things like legal requirements, local best business practices, and so on. And then we have as a third pillar, the language scope of our products, and all three combined is what we call globalization at SAP. Now, when we look at some of the typical areas, the typical examples of topics where localization is a big topic, in the area of payments, for example, we often have country formats that are used. We also have in the more modern world, we have things like e-payments when we integrate with, for example, PayPal or Alipay or so. In the area of invoicing, we have a lot of country-specific requirements. Also, of course, in regards to the business to government communication that is often attached meanwhile to invoicing and specifically electronic invoicing. And just to mention maybe another very, very big topic is taxes, all kinds of taxes, be it direct, be it indirect taxes, tax reporting, tax management overall is of course a very, very big topic. So these are just examples of topics that have a very high, I would say, localization flavor. Of course, we take care of other topics as well, but the majority of the activities that we do in globalization services really circulates around the 10 topics that we have mentioned here. A new upcoming topic that is not directly mentioned here on that slide is social media integration as well. Many of you would be aware that in the Western world, we use social media that are in some cases very much different than from what, for example, is being used in Greater China or in Japan or in Korea, where we have just different types and different tools for social media like WeChat and Line in Japan and KakaoTalk in Korea and so on. And also the topic of social media integration is a topic that we consider as the scope of globalization services. So one of the newer examples, which moves a little bit away from the legal requirements, which more handles the local best business practices that I've just mentioned. When we look at, globalization services, first of all, as an organization and the scope that we are handling, we typically handle not the very, very large multi-year development programs where several hundred people work on one software product and after 2 or 3 years they deliver and ship something. So the typical localization business for us as a unit is like more a high volume business where we deliver roughly 1,000 legal changes every year to our customers, where we translate a number of 1.7 billion words per year. This is really a huge amount as part of the product UI and documentation and so on translation, where we deliver solutions that our customers use in more than 180 countries in the world. And of course, this is only possible because we have an extremely experienced team that is really very well established since many decades at SAP. I would also want to explain a little bit how globalization services works and what is the working model. How can we ensure also to keep our customers compliant and to learn about all these local requirements and make sure they are being considered in our software. I think we have a very unique setup across the software industry where we have localization product managers that sit in all parts of the world, that sit in more than 40 locations across the world. And what they do is they monitor the local legislation. They analyze requirements, work a lot with our customers, also, of course, with our field teams, with consultants in the region. They work with the SAP user groups, and they also connect and work, of course, with legal authorities. And these localization product managers, they, at the end of the day, define what we need to do for a certain country. And they also create the requirements documents and the specifications which our engineering teams that are organized in our development hubs across the world, which our engineering teams really utilize in order to build the software that we need in a specific country. It is also important to mention that our engineering teams also are experts in localization. They are specialists in a certain localization domain like tax management and electronic invoicing and so on. And they are also specialized, of course, in certain products like S4HANA, SuccessFactors, Concur and so on. And the collaboration of these two units within our SAP Globalization Services team is really something which is a little bit the secret sauce of localization in the way how we understand it at SAP. Yeah, I would, to finish my short introduction on globalization services, I would just want to showcase and highlight one example of how we showcase our country versions also to our customers. This is the example of S4HANA on-premise financials and operations in that case, where we have a standard localization for 64 countries. And this is one piece of information that is also showcased in the support portal available to our customers under the hashtag globalization, where you can find all kinds of these country roadmaps and country versions. And what you can see, of course, we have some white spots still, but the country coverage and the country reach that we have as SAP is really something that is a benchmark across the industry, I would say. Yeah, this is a quick introduction. I would maybe pause for a second in order to see if there are some immediate questions. And after that, I think we'll hand over then to Jan Klaas, who will showcase a little bit the more modern world of how we do the development and what kind of services that we offer, but that go a little bit on top of the traditional localization work that we are still doing. Yeah, let's open it up for some initial questions, if there are some.
So if you would like to add a question to Stefan and his team, you can either use the chat window or you hover over the mega menu at the bottom and there you can there you can see the question and answer section and you can write your answer down. It's up to you. And if there are no questions, thanks very much, Stefan. So we can hand over to the next speaker, Jan Klaas.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Yes, my name is Jan-Klaas Heinzon. I'm responsible for architecture and technology at Globalization Services. And I would like to give you some input on what we do to tackle two big challenges that we are currently facing at SAP and in the overall industry. And that affect Globalization Services quite a bit. One thing is the overall movement to the public cloud. So SAP so far was big in on-premise software with a lot of freedom for the individual customer to extend their software with all kinds of modifications. In the public cloud, the world is different. And this has also an impact on localization, on localizability. The other thing is that SAP is growing, not only buying, acquiring new companies that come with functionality that is possibly affected by legal requirements, but also we are re-engineering our software quite a bit, also to get into the public cloud. And these topics need reaction by us in order to, with our current capacity to do the same things to ensure that customers are compliant with all the SAP solutions. One thing is cloud services. So there is functionality, country-specific functionality, that we traditionally build into the existing product. So in the old days, this was one product, ERP. Nowadays, there are multiple products. And these products partially have the same functionality and the same legal requirements apply. And instead of now building it again and again into these products, we thought of a way to rather do it only once and centralize it. And public cloud services are, of course, a great technology to do this. And here you see on the right side 11 services that we have currently published, partially for public and internal usage, partially for internal usage only, which allow us to decouple legal functionality from the consuming core applications so that we do it only once. On the left side, I listed in general our motivation to do this cloud service approach. So one very important point, as I said, is reuse. Reuse by multiple SAP applications. So for example, if you look at the topic tax calculation, it doesn't make much sense to implement the whole tax determination and calculation logic in every SAP product, and there are plenty of that calculate product taxes, but somehow find a way to do it only once and call this service from every application that needs taxes. Another thing of reuse is that we would like to offer our localization functionality to the larger ecosystem of development partners or customer IT. And this is possible with sub-cloud platform, cloud services. And this is why we published and will publish more and more functionality regarding localization as services on the cloud platform that can also be consumed by the development ecosystem for their own developments. And the last two bullet points, the last four bullet points here on the left side are actually reasons SAP-wide to go more and more for public cloud services. Decoupling responsibilities so that there is a greater independence of LOBs and development teams is one thing. Faster feature shipment in public cloud, you can down to whatever daily shipments even, which is of course also very attractive for country-specific functionality because legal changes can hit us quite immediately sometimes. So this technology is great for localization especially. Commercialization or new commercial models, for example, also things like pay-per-use is another reason why overall we go for cloud services. And last but not least, to reduce the overall footprint of the software application by reducing the mandatory core thing. So to come from a large monolith software to a smaller one that is absolutely mandatory and carving out parts of the functionality to external services that then are only used by those customers who really need them. And this is of course, very important also for country-specific functionality. So not every customer needs a Brazilian nota fiscal functionality or whatever. And if we can somehow decouple that from the digital core. This is good in terms of the overall cost of operations. All right. I would like to give you one example. I'm not going to now comment on all these detailed services overall. They spend across all the areas of application that Stefan already mentioned, in financials, taxes, HCM a lot. Electronic invoicing is getting more and more, or document exchange in general is getting more and more relevant in more and more countries. So there will be more of such services coming up. As an example, I show you one thing, which is the tax service. And so a peek into its details. So what you see here in the middle is the tax service and its individual components, which are all individual microservices on the SAP Cloud platform. And the tax service itself is called by multiple SAP applications. Our idea or our goal is at some point in time that really all applications that calculate product tax will offer the tax service as a method to calculate taxes. So you see here any ERP components like S4HANA, S4HANA Cloud, Ariba Invoice, Concur Invoice, etc., would then consume the tax service. The tax service itself has a kind of entry point here, and it comes with an internal tax calculation, which you see here is split into the overall tax content, which is tax rates depending on whatever regions, product classifications, the rules, the derivation trees, how to come to the right rate combination for a given set of master data and product in a transaction, and the calculation itself, so ultimately multiplying rate by base in the easiest case. These are all individual microservices, which consume, again, more general reuse components that we offer at SAP on the cloud platform, in this case, the business rule framework, which comes with the design time and runtime. So we offer internal tax calculation content for many countries, over 100 countries. And we offer also the option to alternatively connect to external partner engines. So a customer can decide to connect partner engines that handle then the tax calculation. And the attractive thing is that this is done once, configured once in the central tax components instead of in multiple SAP software applications that deal with tax calculation. So a big advantage of the central cloud service approach. All right.
Jan Klaas?
Yes?
We have two questions from Bernd here in the chat. So the first one would be, how far is SAP accountability on those service, for example, tax service? And what would happen when there is a wrong calculation and the officials would charge you penalties?
That typically the standard answer is the customer is responsible to be compliant. SAP offers a tool. Nevertheless, and we of course update the delivered content with any legal changes. Nevertheless, I think the politically and legally correct answer is ultimately the customer is responsible for the compliance. We support with our tools, but we are not typically being charged or so if, for example, a tax rate was not updated early enough. Yeah.
All right, Bernd, I hope this answers your question. Thanks.
There was a second question or?
How far is SAP accountability on those services, for example, tax services?
All right. Yeah. Okay. Then I go on. And I will now talk a little bit about our approach to scale with S4HANA Cloud. So you saw already in Stefan's slides that we offer standard country versions. And these are not all the countries in the world, but a subset. In S4 Cloud, for example, it's about 40 or 41. S4 on-premise, financials, you saw just 64 or so. Overall, there are close to 200 countries. So that's one thing. Now, how do we scale? One thing is what I just showed you through the localization hub. We carved out some legal functionality to the cloud platform and offer some partner extension functionality for tax, for example, and centralize some localization functionality. And then we also now work on enabling the development partner ecosystem, partner and customer IT ecosystem, to be able to implement localization on their own. Because our goal at SAP is not to provide localization for all countries in the world. There will be always countries where SAP doesn't see a huge sales opportunity, which justifies high investments in localization. But of course, our customers have subsidiaries in these countries, or we want to sell in these countries. So what do? In traditional on-premise, they extended the software by any means. They can modify the source code. And this is no longer possible in public cloud. So here, only restricted features can be used, which is called extensibility features. And with this localization toolkit for S4 Cloud, we describe use cases, how to tackle localization challenges, and also we summarize what features exist in S4 Cloud with which you can extend the solution. I explain this in a little bit more detail. Just what we are talking about, you saw that already a bit when Stefan showed what are the areas affected by localization. Here again, in this fan overview, each segment of this fan shows one part of typical ERP software which could be affected by localization. In some countries, more segments, in some countries, less. So from a lot, of course, is going on in financials, financial accounting, tax is a huge topic, the whole reporting topic, asset accounting, invoicing, supplier and customer invoicing, electronic invoicing, inventory management and valuation, open items management, payment files, payment media like bill of exchange, and of course the area of languages. So we have use cases in our experience of whatever 30 years of localization development, and we want to share these as best practices with the partner and customer ecosystem. So to help them to develop localization for countries that we don't support on their own. This is the overall idea of localization toolkit. We do this with various parts of our technology, in-app extensibility, side-by-side extensibility, business configuration, and also built-in, let's say, business features of S4 itself. This is somehow summarized on this slide here. So typically when you do localization, a lot is covered already with business configuration content. SAP at the moment is building a new central business configuration component, which will be used in S4 Cloud and later on also in other applications. So this tool will be used also in a great deal to enable partners and customers to ship their own configuration content. Then we have on the middle left part here, the in-app features and in-app extensibility technique of S4 Cloud itself. These are fields, I mean, additional attributes, UI extensions, business logic extensions like additional validations or defaulting of extension fields, new UIs, new reporting views, such things which are all called in-app extensibility features, which are not only for localization, but in general for any kinds of extensions of S4 Cloud, which we, for localization purposes, also make use of. Then we have modules specifically developed by GS for partner enablement. This is the payment medium workbench, which with which new payment files and account statements and so can be created for new countries or existing countries. Reporting is a huge topic, compliance reporting, using the existing so-called CDS views to create new reports that need to be submitted then to governments in electronic way or classic way. So this is all part of S4 Cloud in application extensibility. And then for more decoupled extensions, process enhancements and so on, the subcloud platform, so-called side-by-side extensibility, is the right method of choice, making use of what is being offered as part of the so-called SAP Cloud SDK. The tech service itself is an example of that, where part of a functionality of a process is carved out and runs on a central cloud component. The localization toolkit now offers a view on business use cases for localization. For example, validate a new legal ID or create a new document number range for a customer invoice ID or so. So really tangible use cases that we know of from customer projects or from our standard localization, and to provide you with how-to documents, how this can be solved using the existing tools and technologies, really with code examples, screenshots, etc. We've just published the first version of the localization toolkit, and we intend to grow this really a lot as we go with more and more partner and customer development projects. So to include additional use case documents, to build up a real community where you can get in touch with us to get coaching, to deal with questions and answers. We really want to grow this like other open source communities to make our touch points with the development partner ecosystem and customer ecosystem really, really fruitful. So there are basically two main use cases for customer and partner localization. One is new countries. So as I said, we in S4Cloud at the moment, we have 40 countries. There are requests for new small countries like here in this left example, some African country. This will work. This is typically going to work for relatively simple legislation. So where the kinds of extensions that one has to make are not so intrusive, not so disruptive, but rather are add-on-like thing, content, some reports, forms, etc. Typically also this wouldn't cover a complete country version, but rather it's very customer specific. They have a subsidiary with a certain subset of processes that must run there. So this is going to work for this kind of countries. Often there will be the question, okay, can you provide us with a whitelist or a blacklist? So for which countries it doesn't work? Our standard answer is we cannot really, because it's very, very customer specific. So we even saw in the early days a customer that ran S4HANA Cloud in Brazil, although it was not yet localized, which is supposed to be the most complex country. But for their processes, it just was enough. So new countries is one thing. And the other thing is what we call on the right-hand side here, last mile localization. This is accounting for the fact that a localization or a country version is never super complete. There are always industry-specific features that we don't cover, that are affected by legal requirements, maybe special taxes or whatever, that we don't cover. And this complementary localization needs to be done, be possible to be done by partners and customers as well. And this is what we call last mile. So here we are talking about additional forms, additional reports, maybe additional taxes, connected external tax engines, and business configuration content. Lastly, this is the so-called community page. It's in the SAP Community Localization Toolkit. You can just search for it, then you get to this landing page. Here you see some overview of what it is about. And when you scroll down, you see those how-to documents in the expert content where you see really examples how to tackle a specific use case. And as I said, this is going to grow. At the moment, the content is relatively small yet, but we are really putting a lot of focus in growing this whole thing to make this more and more complete. Now, this was basically my presentation. Now, one thing is, with this I hand over to the third slot, localization development is different because it is more often affected by changes. And these changes are not because the software is buggy, but it's legal changes. So if you, you as a development partner, or customer developer, get into that topic localization, this is a challenge that you need to face. And we came up with an interesting idea how to use machine learning to help identification of those changes. And this is part of the next cool presentation of Vivek. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you, Jan. Good afternoon, everyone.
Vivek, I'm sorry, I have to interrupt you because we have a question in the chat. Mm-hmm. Again, from Bernd. How can though, so it's in regards to the presentation Jan Klaas just mm-hmm. gave. How can those cloud tools cover specific legal requirements? For example, in Germany, GOBD, tax auditor access as a direct access or a via file access. Besides, everything needs to be documented in a specific way. Are those tools so open and a tax calculation can be shown or explained to a tax auditor?
Yeah, well, in terms of tax calculation, yes, we have a pretty transparent way to show how the tax engine determined the tax calculation. The other examples, German, GEO, BD, whatever, I can't say anything intelligent about it. I'm also not so completely sure what the question intends to lead to. So,
but if you want to speak up, you can also raise your hand and then I can unmute you.
Or we clarify that offline if you drop us a mail or so.
Yeah, that would be also possible. Yeah, great. And we have one more question from the very beginning. It was about roadmap. Mm-hmm. Should we do it now or?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah? Okay. So, so Neil wanted to know if about the roadmap of localization for India, especially in regards to e-invoicing.
Yeah, we have India invoicing. I don't have in mind exactly. I mean, it's a large topic. We can also follow up on that, of course, separately. Overall, because in India we have a lot of legal changes in the last years. The very large GST legal change, of course, as many of you would know who are familiar a little bit with India. And so we have a whole roadmap of localization topics for the Indian subcontinent in place. I think we should definitely touch base separately on the specific question of e-invoicing. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, Sunil, you can get in contact with the team offline.
Yep, anytime.
All right, then we hand over to Vivek.
Great. Thanks everyone. I'd like to demo the law to action use case for you today. So basically the solution tries to simplify the whole legal change process. And for that, let's start with the law to action, the legal change process without machine learning as it is right now. So essentially what happens is there are governments. These governments publish several laws and there's a user. This user looks at the website maybe every day, maybe once a week to check if there are new legal changes. Then determines if it's relevant or not, which products are affected, what is the purpose, sits together with several other legal experts and comes up with the requirements, the actual requirements. And these are stored inside the JIRA. That's a symbol for JIRA, by the way. And finally, after the requirements get created, you have the code. So these requirements are then taken by a developer and then configurations are made inside the software or changes are directly made into the code. This is not only a very time consuming process, but largely leads to the fact that the user spends a lot of time analyzing maybe even irrelevant legal changes, time better spent on the ones that are directly relevant. So this is where law to action tries to come in. And so what we're trying to do is the first step, which is the web crawling. The web crawling aspect automates the searching of new legal requirements. So once every hour, there's a crawler which goes on a website and checks if there's a new legal change. If there's a new legal change, the user automatically gets notified. And that's the first step of the process done. Secondly, because SAP already has a large database of existing legal changes, because whenever there was a relevant legal change, it was already saved into the JIRA database, we can use our machine learning models to train an algorithm. And this algorithm will then try and rank the relevant legal changes. So all these incoming legal changes will be ranked. At the top, you'd have the relevant ones. At the bottom, you'd have the not so relevant ones. So essentially your work is being prioritized. And then finally, we also help in assisting the collaboration between the legal experts. So what we try to do here is go through the text and identify which paragraphs are relevant. We try to highlight some important keywords if the user requires it, important dates, people, and the like. So we try to assist in this process. And finally, we build an API integration, which tries to without you even having to leave the app, you can create an issue. So this API integration can then assist you in creating your backlog items, which are then used for the development teams to create the changes in the code. I should note that this feature is right now not available in the beta scope. So if you were to join the beta program right now, it's not in the beta scope, it's in the POC scope, but it is on the roadmap. So this feature is something that will come. And in the future, so this is the whole purpose of the app. Essentially, we would also automatically like to change the configuration of the actual product So without any human intervention, essentially, a log will get determined, the requirements will be met, and then we can automatically decide which configurations will be changed. So that's the purpose, that the direction the app is going to. We're naturally very far from this, but close nonetheless. And this will lead to a happy user, we believe. And now to the demo. So what are we seeing here? We're seeing right now the main page of legislation.gov.uk. So this is how a website like legislation.gov would try and publish all the legal changes. So if we click on all legal changes, they're published using an RSS feed. There are many different formats. This is one of them. Firstly, you can see that there are many different entries. So you would have the links being individually shown like so for each of these entries. We can open one of them. Oops. And this is what the LPM would do. The user, the legal expert, would then click on the PDF icon and then go through the link and then identify whether or not this legal change is relevant or not. And now let me show you the app. This is the app itself. So the app will automatically go on this website, scour all the relevant legal changes, and automatically display all of the PDFs and try to extract the text. At the top, you'd have the very relevant ones, and the further you go down, you'd see the very not relevant ones. Something important to note is here you see two classifications. You see the machine learning classification. So this is the classification that the model gave the document, and this is the user classification. So the user can then retrofit the model and clarify, okay, no, this is a correct prediction by the model, and this is, or this was a wrong prediction. It happens sometimes that, as you can see, the model thinks something is relevant, but the user says, no, it's not relevant. You can go and filter by the published date. You can go and search for the title. For example, you would only like to see, let's say, the non-relevant ones, and you can filter. First page. So here you can only filter by the non-relevant classification ones. And let's take a look at one of the legal changes. So what are we seeing here? Right now we're seeing at the top the title of the legal change. Then we have the machine learning classification of the legal change. We can see that the machine learning model marked it as relevant. We can see the certainty of the model. So the model is very sure that this is a very relevant legal change. And in the middle, we can see the text. So the text is highlighted in different shades of blue. Here you can see a lighter shade of blue. This is a darker shade of blue. If the model thinks the text is more relevant for you, it will highlight it in a darker shade. You can also notice that some of these words are highlighted in yellow. So these are user-specified keywords. The user decided that he would like to be notified whenever he sees this word, in this case, Kodul Fiskal. And you will get an email notification whenever there's a new document with this specific keyword in it. Also note that sometimes you can see, let me zoom in, here, sometimes the text is boldened as well. So this is, it's called rapid accelerated keyword extraction. Essentially, it's an algorithm which tries to identify automatically without any user input what keywords might be relevant for you. Another interesting thing to note is at the top, in case you would like to have more information about past legal changes or you are not sure how to proceed with this specific legal change, you can take a look at how other legal changes were dealt with in the past. And you can, if you click on this, you can see that this is a Jira page with other Jira issue tickets. So these are similar past legal changes. If after all this, you're still not convinced that this is a legal change that is relevant for you, you can click on set as not relevant. Or if this is actually relevant for you, you can click on relevant, and then you can see the Jira the Jira button where you can create a new issue, assign an existing issue, assign a recent issue, essentially an end-to-end process within this app. Yep, you can also switch off the text analysis if it's too much for you.
Isaac, there's a question in regards to that overview here. Gunnar is asking how he can see the country affected. I think that was the prior overview you showed before you went into that detail.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is specifically for Romania. So I'm showing the Romanian one because there are Romanian users predominantly using this app right now.
But can you see it somewhere that it's in regards to Romania if you're not aware of this speech? Ah, yeah.
Here you can choose which country you want. So currently there's a machine learning model for every country. So right now we have a Romanian one, a Russian one, a Ukrainian one, a British one, Poland, Kazakhstan.
Yeah. And I think I saw when you go into the detail, I also saw there's a little abbreviation of the language. Can you click on one? Mm-hmm. And then you see the similar past legal changes, and then you see LCRO. This is for the language as well, right?
Yeah, this is the country. This is the Romanian country.
Legal. Perfect. Yeah. I hope this answers your question, Günther. And we had another one in the Q&A section. It's also from Günther. He said, we have just recently learned that for SAP, there is a big difference between legal change and legal requirement. Can you clarify this as well?
Do you want to say this?
Yeah, so we have, of course, yeah. I think in general it is what we perceive or what we consider as a legal change that we would definitely deliver to our customers is when we have an existing functionality in our software and this existing functionality would change due to a change in the legislation or something like that, then we would consider this as a legal change which we would for sure deliver to our customers. Sometimes there are new legal requirements where it's always for us a discussion of, you know, how many customers are affected, what is the nature of the change, do our customers have an alternative like utilizing partner solutions and so on. And an example for a new legal requirement in that regard would be that, for example, there is a new tax, there are new tax reports introduced, or there is a certain country now implements an electronic invoicing process, which was not there before or something like that, right? So in these cases, we would always decide based on business priorities, whether we would deliver such a functionality or not. So this is more of a portfolio decision then.
Thank you. I hope this answers your question, Günther. And then Vivek, you can go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So right now we took a look at the relevant paragraphs. If we scroll down, we can also see the original document itself. So this is where the text was extracted from. In this case, this was a Word document. So if you click on this, you can download the Word document and open it. So this is how the document looks like in real without the paragraph highlighting. And if you have multiple classifiers, you can see how each classifier ranked the data. Right now, the translation is not available in the beta scope, but so translation and Jira are not available in the beta scope, but it is something that is being considered on the roadmap. By the way, there is a poll question relating to this specific topic, whether or not this translation feature is actually relevant for you. So if you think it's relevant, please click it is, or please submit your answers in the poll.
Yeah, we will show up the poll at the end of the session. Mm-hmm. And when we also open up for question and answer.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Another feature here, you can type in your tag. So if this particular legal change is related to finance, you can create a finance tag. And then later on, when the law is being published, you can search for the tag and then find the law quicker. That's the demo.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Vivek. I think what we have seen in the last 50, 55 minutes is, as mentioned, roughly how SAP, how we understand globalization and localization of software, what new modern ways we do in order to, first of all, be more efficient internally, but also offer this flexibility and faster time to market to our customers. And also one example of how we leverage innovative, intelligent technologies in order to do our business a little bit better and also enable this, of course, for our customers. So this tool, which Vivek has shown, Law to Action, is available, as said, as a beta currently to our customers. And it can be extended, of course, to other sources. Like I could imagine in the automotive industry, you also have a lot of regulations. So you don't necessarily have to connect it to data sources for software legal changes in the finance world or in the payroll world or so. It can be extended to other areas easily as well. All right, so I think we would move into a final Q&A session.
Yes, perfect. So I send a little note here in the chat. Mm-hmm. So you can raise a question via typing this in the chat. You can use the Q&A section. You can find it in the black menu when you hover over it at the bottom of the page, or you can also raise your hand and then I can help you unmute yourself. And in the meanwhile, I would like to launch our poll. So we would kindly ask you to contribute to that one. I hope you can see it now. And there are the questions which are important for the team to follow up with. So at the moment, there are no questions, but we can give the audience some time. And in the meanwhile, I also give you the information where you can listen to the recording afterwards if you miss any information in here. All right. So if there are no more questions, then I can only thank you three that you joined the SAP community call. It was a really interesting conversation which we had today. And if anyone would like to ask a question later on, you can also write an email to sapcommunity@sap.com. So we are always here to connect you with the team. Thank you very much, Stefan, Jan, Klaas, and Vivek for the presentation. And I see there's one question. Oh, this was shortly before I want to close the call. It's in the question and answer section. Well, the tool looks very interesting, but which SAP customer group shall this use, or is it basically for internal purposes?
Mm-hmm. The Law to Action toolkit?
Yeah, I think the question is definitely related to Law to Action. It is, so we use it internally for our purposes. This is one thing, but it can be used theoretically in all areas and in all aspects where you deal with legislation and finding out whether legislation or which legislation is relevant for your business. Can be in the software industry, can be very regulated topics or industries. So it is not restricted to the use case that Vivek has shown for our internal purpose. It can be used flexibly.
Perfect, thank you. We have another one. Localization kits are available on Partner Edge portal. Question?
Yes, we are aligned with Partner Edge and the overall, for example, S4HANA Cloud Partner Care community. Mm-hmm. Localization is one specific aspect. We support the partner ecosystem with our own people, and we are basically embedded in all the other Partner Edge and other partner related processes at SAP. Yes?
Perfect, thank you. All right, then thanks very much again. I give you guys 2 minutes back of your life. Thanks for joining very much, and I hope we hear from each other more in the near future.
Absolutely, thanks very much, Svea and team, for organizing, and also to all the participants for joining, who was very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.